Hello friends, welcome to EPG Pathshala. Myself Komal Yadav, research scholar of Galgotia's University, attached with CFSL CBI in New Delhi. In today's module, we are discussing about forensic psychiatry, definition, classification, McNaughton's rule, and the learning outcomes of the module is to understand the various aspects associated with forensic psychiatry, to make the learners understand the various types of mental disorder, the importance of legal aspects associated with mental disorders. Introduction. Forensic psychology is the interaction between psychology and justice system. It involves understanding fundamental legal principles, particularly with regards to expert witness, testimony, and the specific content area of the concern. For example, competence to stand trial, child custody, or workplace discrimination. Forensic psychiatry is a branch of medicine which focuses on the interface of law and mental health. It includes forensic psychiatric consultants in the wide variety of legal matters, include expert testimony, as well as clinical work with perpetrators and victims. A psychiatrist is a medical doctor who has completed several years of additional training in the understanding, diagnosis, and treatment of mental disorder. A forensic psychiatrist is a psychiatrist who has additional training and or experience related to the interface of mental health or mental illness and the low insanity or unsoundness of mind. It can be defined as a disease of the mind which affects the personality, mental status, critical faculties, emotional process, and interaction of social environment. Mentally ill person. Any person who is in need of treatment by reason of any mental disorder other than mental retardation. The Mental Health Act of 1987 was introduced to consolidate and amend the law relating to the treatment and care of mentally ill persons to make better provisions with respect to their property and affairs and for matter connected therewith of incidental therefore. A mentally ill person needs to be restrained for own safety or for the safety of others. If the lawful guardian of such a patient is unable to keep him under the control for any reason, or if there be no guardian at all, the state is legally justified to take charge of such a patient and to put him under restraint. Restraint may be immediate or by admission to a psychiatric hospital or registered psychiatric nursing home after certain conditions have been complied with. Next, defenses. Defenses is of many types like matrix defense, mental disorder, insanity, abuse defense, idiot defense, impossibility defense, defense of infancy, mental defense, intoxication defense. First, the matrix defense. The matrix defense is a term applied to several legal cases of a defense based on the matrix films, where reality is actually a computer generation. Symbolism and the real world is quite different from what reality is perceived to be. In using this defense, the defendant claims that he committed a crime because he believed he was in the matrix and not in the real world. This is a version of insanity defense and considered a descendant of the taxi driver. डिफेंस ऑफ जॉन हिंकले वन ऑफ द फर्स्ट डिफेंसेस बेस्ड ऑन बर्निंग रियलिटी विद द मूवीज. नेक्स्ट इज द मेंटल डिसऑर्डर डिफेंस. इन द क्रिमिनल लॉज ऑफ ऑस्ट्रेलिया एंड कैनेडा द डिफेंस ऑफ मेंटल डिसऑर्डर समटाइम्स कॉल्ड द डिफेंस ऑफ मेंटल इलनेस इज अ लीगल डिफेंस बाय एक्सक्यूज by which a defendant may argue they should not to be held criminally liable for breaking the law because they were mentally ill at the time of alleged criminal actions. Next is abuse defense. The abuse defense is a defense in which the argues that a prior history of justifies violent retaliations, while the term most often refers to instances of, or it is also refers more generally to any attempt by the defense to use a or social condition of deflect responsibility away from the defendant. Sometimes the concept is referred to as the abuse excuse. In a particular by the critics of the idea that guilty people may use past victimization to diminish the responsibility of their crimes. Next is the idiot defense. The idiot defense is a strategical term for a legal strategy where a defendant claims innocence by virtue of having been ignorant of facts of which the defendant would normally be expected to be aware. Other terms used for this tactic includes dumb, CEO defense, like dummy defense, ostrich defense, and sergeant's clutch defense. Next is the impossibility defense. An impossibility defense is a criminal defense occasionally used when a defendant is accused of a criminal attempt that failed only because the crime was actually or legally possible to commit. Factual impossibility is rarely an adequate defense at common law. In the United States, 37 states have ruled out factual impossibility as defense to the crime of attempt. This is not to be confused with the mistake of fact defense, which may be defense to a specific intent crime like larceny. Next is the defense of infancy. The defense of infancy is a form of defense known as an excuse, so the defendant falling within the definition of an infant are excluded from criminal liability for their actions if at the relevant time they had not reached an age of criminal responsibility. After reaching the initial age, there may be levels of responsibility dictated by age and the type of offense committed. Next is mental disorder or insanity defense. In the mental disorder defense or insanity defense is the claim that is not responsible for their actions during the episode of psychiatric illness or mental handicap. Exemption of the insane from full criminal punishment dates back to at least same. There are different definitions of legal insanity such as M. Norton's rules, the Dhamma rules, the American Legal Institute definition, and various miscellaneous provisions, for example, relating to the lack of mens rea. In the criminal laws of Australia and Canada, the term defense of mental disorder or defense of mental illness are used. Next is intoxication defense. In criminal law, the intoxication defense is a defense by which a defendant may claim diminished responsibility on the basis of substance intoxication. Although general intent crimes do not require an intent to break the law. Just an unlawful act, actus reus, and an intent to act in such a fashion. Specific intent crimes such as residential burglary require a certain mental state, mens rea, to break the law. And those under the influence of an intoxication substance may be considered to have reduced liability for their actions. Even voluntary intoxication, the knowing and voluntary consumption of alcohol or other drugs can be used as a defense to a specific intent crime. Whereas only involuntary intoxication, my drink was spiked, can be used as a defense to a general intent crime. As for punishment, intoxication may be a mitigating factor that decreases a prison to or jail sentence. An important aspect of forensic psychology is the ability to testify in court as an expert witness, reformulating psychological finding into the legal language of the courtroom, providing information to legal personnel in the way that can be understood. Further, in order to be a credible witness, the forensic psychologist must understand the philosophy, rules, and standards of the judicial system. Primary is an understanding of the adversarial system. There are also rules about hearsay evidence, and most importantly, the exclusionary rule. Lack of a firm grasp of these procedures will result in the forensic psychologist losing credibility in the courtroom. A forensic psychologist can be trained in clinical, social, organizational, or any other branch of psychology. An important aspect of forensic psychology is the ability to testify in court as an expert witness, reformulation, psychological finding into the legal language of the courtroom, providing information to legal personnel in the way that can be understood. Further, in order to be a credible witness, the forensic psychologist must understand the philosophy, rules, and standards of judicial system. Primary is the understanding of the adversarial system. There are also rules about hearsay evidence, and most importantly, the exclusionary rules. Lack of a firm grasp of these procedures will result in the forensic psychologist losing credibility in the courtroom. A forensic psychologist can be trained in clinical, social, organizational, or any other branch of psychology. Forensic psychology practice, malingering, competency evolutions, sanity evolutions, and other evolutions, ethical implications. First is malingering. An important and pressing question in any type of forensic assessment is the issue of malingering and deception. In some criminal cases, the court views malingering or feigned illness as obstruction of justice and sentences the defendant accordingly. Next is the competency evolutions. If there is a question of the accused competency to stand trial, a forensic psychologist is appointed by the court to examine and assess the individual. The individual may be in custody or may have been released on bail based on the forensic assessment. A recommendation is made to the court whether or not the defendant is competent to proceed to trial. If the defendant is considered incompetent to proceed, the report or testimony will include the recommendations. for the intervening period during which an attempt at restoring the individual's competency to understand the court and legal proceedings as well as participate appropriately in the defense will be made. Often this is an issue of committed on the advice of a forensic psychologist to a psychiatric treatment facility until such as the individual is deemed competent. Next is sanity evaluation. The forensic psychologist may also be appointed by the court to evaluate the defendant's state of mind at the time of the offense. These are defendants who the judge, prosecutor, or the public defender believe though personal interaction with the defendant or though reading the police report may have been significantly impaired at the time of the offense. Next is other evaluation. Forensic psychologists are frequently asked to make an assessment of an individual's dangerousness or the risk of reoffending. They may provide information and recommendations necessary for sentencing purposes, grants of prohibition, and the formulation of conditions of parole, which often involves an assessment of the offender's ability to be rehabilitated. They are also asked question of the witness credibility and malingering. Occasionally, they may also provide criminal profiles to law enforcement. Scope of forensic psychiatry. Criminal forensic psychiatry, civil forensic psychiatry, administrative forensic psychiatry. These are the scope of forensic sciences. In criminal forensic psychiatry involves competency to stand trial, legal insanity, expert witness, testify, treatment of the mental ill offender. In civil forensic psychiatry involves personal injury cases, domestic relations matter, testamentary capacity, testimonial capacity, competency to vote. In administrative forensic psychiatry, it involves the confidentiality, privilege, communications, privacy issues, right to treatment, commitment or involuntary hospitalization. Next is the classification of mental disorders. Mental retardation, mental subnormality, mental handicap, organic psychosis, dementia, drug-induced psychosis, confusional state and psychosis, falling, epilepsy, pregnancy and childbirth, trauma and general diseases functions, psychosis. These are schizophrenia, paranoid state, affective disorder, mania depression, neurotic disorder, personality disorders. For example, sociopathic personality and sexual deviations. Next is the classification diagnosis of mental illness. In 1952, the American Psychiatric Association first published the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorder, DSM-1. The latest edition, DSM-4, was published in 1994. The International Classification of Disease, 10th Revision Clinical Modification, ICD-10-CM, published by the World Health Organization Diagnostic. Methods, computed tomography, CT, magnetic resonance imaging, MRI, position emission tomography, these are PET. Dementia. Dementia is described as deterioration of intellectual function and other cognitive skills, leading to decline in the ability to perform activities of daily living. prevalence increases rapidly with age. It doubles every 5 years after age 60. Alzheimer's disease and vascular dementias are the two most common types, accounting for up to 90% of the cases of established dementia in about 2:1 ratio. Sign and symptoms, these are steady, inexorable decline in intellectual function over 2 to 10 years, culminating in total dependence and death, often due to infection. Most common symptom is diminished short memory. Other symptom includes personality change, emotional lability, and poor judgment. Occurrence of mood swings, depression, and euphoria. Diagnosis. Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, 4th edition, that is DSM-4, criteria for dementia. Impairment of memory, impairment of at least one other domain of cognition. The key to diagnosis is a DOE history. Detailed drug review. Over-the-counter drug and ophthalmic preparation, history of alcohol to be obtained, screening set of laboratory tests, for example, CBC, electrolytes, albumin, renal function, liver function, thyroid function, and vitamin B12 levels. Dynamic imaging of cerebral blood flows by single photon emission computed tomography, SPECT. Neuropsychological testing, the psychosis. Psychosis is a generic term for the mental states in which the components of rational thought and the perception are severely impaired, particularly associated with schizophrenia. Bipolar disorder or severe clinical depression. It should be distinguished from the concept of insanity and psychopathy. Also to be distinguished from the state of delirium and mental illness. Causes. First is physical circumstances, electrolyte disorder, urinary tract infections, mental illness, bipolar disorder, and schizophrenia. Drug use, amphetamines, LSD, PCP, cocaine, or chronic psychological stress, withdrawal from CNS depressant drug, alcohol, and benzodiazepines. Signs and symptoms, hallucination, delusion, and paranoia, though disorder lack of insight. Diagnosis. Numinocephalography 1953 to obtain the first brain image of person with psychosis. Gray matter reduction in cortex of people with psychosis. Sensory perception active during psychosis. Increased activation in the right hemisphere of the brain. Next is delirium. It is an acute reversible disorder characterized by confusion and impairment of consciousness, disorientation, mostly commonly time, emotional lability, hallucination or illusion, and inappropriate, impulsive, irrational or violent behavior. The mental faculty of an individual does not work properly. It may be seen in high grade fever or due to overwork. Mental stress, acute poisoning, dhatura, chronic alcoholics or drug intoxication. Delirium is not a disease, but it develops as a result of medical condition. Acute means that is happen suddenly, change in thinking or consciousness develop over a few hours or days. Patient may die from exhaustion in a week or two. sign and symptoms. Patient seems less aware of the environment. Memory may be affected. Trouble speaking or understanding. Delusion and hallucination common. Restlessness and irritability. Mood swings and sleepiness. Causes: severe infection and high fever, dehydration, diseases of kidney or liver, lack of certain vitamins, hormonal imbalances, lack of oxygen, head injury, reaction due to drug alcohol or prescription medications, after surgery effects. Next is schizophrenia. Schizophrenia is derived from the Greek word schizo, that is split, and phren, that is mind, and was coined by the Eugenia Blücher to refer to the lack of interaction between thought processes and perception. Severe mental illness characterized by persistent defects in the perception or expression of reality. Schizophrenia does not involve a person changing among distinct multiple personalities. Onset of schizophrenia typically occur in the late adolescence or early adulthood, with males tending to show symptoms earlier than female. Causes: stressful life events, drug uses, use of stimulant or hallucinogenic drugs, cannabis use, smoking, tobacco. Diagnosis: significant loss of brain gray matter, coronal MR scan decreases, prefrontal brain functions decreases, enlarged ventricles in the brain decreases the brain activities. Next is the McNaughton's rule, that is very important. Denial: McNaughton killed the Prime Minister's secretary by mistake for the Prime Minister under an insane belief that the government was persecuting him. He was tried and acquitted on the ground of insanity and committed to the Bethlehem Hospital, the House of Lords. Then sent a number of questions to the judge of England, who returned answer in the form of rules, which are reported in 10C and WF 200. The silent points covered under the McNaughton's rules are as follows. First is, person acting under the influence of an insane delusion are punishable if they knew at the time of committing the crime that they were acting contrary to law. Every man is presumed sane and have two sufficient reasons to be held responsible for these crimes. To establish a defense on the ground of insanity, it must be clearly proved that at the time of committing the act, the accused was laboring under such a defect of reason from disease of the mind as not to know the nature and the quality of the act he was doing, or if he did know it, then he did not know he was doing what was wrong. If the accused was conscious that the act was one that he ought not to do, and if the act was at the same time contrary to the law of land, he is punishable. A person under a partial delusion is to consider as if the fact with respect to which the delusion exists were real. Legal test of insanity. Section 84 IPC, nothing is an offense which is done by a person who at the time of doing it is by reason of unsoundness of mind, incapable of knowing the nature of the act, or that he is doing what is either wrong or contrary to law. So friends, at the end of the module, you must be learned the various aspects associated with forensic psychiatry and the various type of mental disorders and the legal aspects associated with mental disorders. Thank you friends for watching. My best wishes. Thank you so much.